wanted to do this because it's important to me. It's important to find passion and something to take me back to the root of why I even chose this career to be in.
A new diverse line of Ken dolls. There are 7 different skin tones to choose from.
The crime is the fact they're here in the first place.
I know, but
that's the crime. So if you get picked up, I don't care.
And when somebody says you hit like a girl, it's like, well, what does that mean?
It is a matter of representation.
Equal is beautiful.
2 videos of police fatally shooting 2 black men.
6 of the presidential advisory on HIV and AIDS, they resigned last week.
Stories that really would help that younger generation is coming up in that business.
To tell a teenager that she should stick to lip gloss when she's being directly impacted is frankly irresponsible.
Same-sex marriage legal.
Let me just say, it all matters, folks. Optics matters, words matter, actions matter, records matter.
Should I put my hair down? I feel like I look hideous. I'm just gonna floor it out. What's going on? Good, how are you?
Yeah.
Yep.
Both U.S. citizens?
Yes.
I don't remember like when my dad told us how he crossed the border.
Not thousands of U.S. citizens will have to give up their private land to build the border wall.
I was very angry, and I just kept saying to Raih over and over again, how can they do that? How is that possible in the United States?
He was undocumented until we were 10. And so everything was kind of out of fear, like driving anywhere. My parents worked so hard to make sure that all of us had the best education. I had friends like Angela Barton, Rebecca, Kathleen Carton. And so I just thought I was just like them. I was like, okay, I'm just, you know, I didn't see race or color or anything.
I came from Port Arthur, Texas. Port Arthur, Texas, it was the east side and the west side. On the west side, all the black people lived. On the east side, all the white people lived.
And then one day my dad was gonna go look for work, and I went with him, and he was knocking on doors looking for work.
I see there's a lot of shopping centers that young people go to, and I go to them now. But in Port Arthur, there was no shopping center, so you used to go to what we call going downtown.
There was one house that we stopped at, and there was this man, and he was outside with his golden retriever, beautiful, beautiful dog, and I just remember thinking, oh, that's such a beautiful dog.
If a woman, or my mother, or my sisters want to buy a pair of shoes, or a dress, or a hat. They got to know their size before they go in. Even if they didn't fit, they got to buy it.
And I was so excited, I was running up to the dog. So I'm walking right behind my dad, and my dad walks up to this gentleman, and he says, yes, sir, I'm looking for work. I make fences, I'm a welder. And the guy just like looks at my dad, and he's like, get out of here, you wetback. We don't like your kind around here. It's like, you Mexican, get out of here. I'll call the police right now.
I have a young man that works with me. He's worked with me for a number of years. He's so intelligent. Went to SMU, you know, graduated top of his class.
So we were driving home, and I asked my dad, I was like, Dad, what does he mean? Like, why was he so mad? Like, why does he mean Mexican? What? Well, because I'm Mexican. And he said, and you're Mexican. And even though you're born here, just remember, like, you're Mexican first, and you will always be seen as Mexican first.
But he went to interview, and they really liked him, the 2 ladies that he had interviewed so far. And he was sitting out in the lobby waiting for them to move him forward to the next person to interview. And evidently they didn't realize they hadn't closed the doors mm-hmm. enough. And he heard them saying, God, he's really smart. It's too bad he's Muslim.
I just remember, like, that's when, like, I remember walking into school and, like, oh, and I was like, I'm Mexican. Like, I just started noticing things.
My grandmother was just a good person. And I went downtown with her one day, and she had to use the facilities. She had to go to the ladies' room, or the toilets, and they would not let her go. She had to subject herself to squatting between 2 stores downtown just so she could relieve herself. And from that point on, I said, single happened.
In that moment, I can imagine he felt like you felt when you really realized, not that anybody did anything dramatic, mm-hmm. in that instance someone did, but you realized, all right, you're not gonna listen to me mm-hmm. because you're judging me just by what you see on the outside. You don't understand what you're about to lose in me because of my perspective.
You know, as a kid, we were protected, but as adults, it's the same stuff that was happening to our parents. It's no different. It's the same exact thing. You go back and watch the news, old stuff, it's the same thing.
Technically, legally speaking, black people have only been free in America for 47 to 49 years. My parents were not born legally free in America.
I was the first person that staged a sit-in in the city of Port Arthur. I wasn't trying to lead a movement. I was just mad because of the way my grandmother was treated. When I got back on the campus on the west side, my principal put me out of school. Some years passed by, and he and I became very close friends. And what I realized, he said, you know what? It's not that I want to do that, but this is the deal. You were putting a lot of people in harm's way because of your emotions, and you didn't know what you were setting in motion just because you're mad. Listen, you know, I didn't know what I was going to do, but I knew this. I know how to get out of there. Because if I had stayed there any time, got comfortable being at home, got comfortable living in a segregated society, we wouldn't be talking properly right now.
I think that for whatever reason in this election, we just kind of separated. And it's just as important to support each other. I think that we forgot that kind of outcome that the Obama election had, and I don't know why.
What we see transpiring now isn't because we have the president that we have. Mm-hmm. It would be lovely if we can point to one person, which we all want. We want someone to blame.
Making Hispanics mad at the blacks, the blacks mad at Hispanics, the conservatives mad at the liberals, and the liberals mad at the centrists, and it's just crazy.
There is something brewing in our culture, in the world today, to just say it's Trump's fault. Come now. There are a million Trumps out there, just like there's a million Obamas. There are people out there who, because of fear or ignorance or whatever, they're just stinkers. We have to look higher.
Good or bad, it got more people interested in what's happening in our country. And I think that's really important.
I want to know how to change people's hearts, you know, and how to change people's minds.
There's a way to communicate with people that says, you know what, if we do this, we're both gonna win. And I think that's part of the conversation is, how do we better talk to people so that they know how to align with us?
How do we make America as good as its promise, that all men are created equal, that the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? How do we make sure, like, we live up to that creed?
The country as a whole has to want to step to this issue.
The nation is almost coming apart. That's what the Kerner Commission was concerned with, the Kerner Commission being the entity that was created to investigate the causes of the urban unrest and to propose solutions. And if you read through their report, one of the areas that they look at for solutions is television.
I'm Larry Yarrell. I am the co-founder and chief operating officer of the Marcus Graham Project.
My name is Lincoln Stevens. I am co-founder and CEO of the Marcus Graham Project. Larry and I met right after high school.
Pretty much started running the streets together, throwing parties, having fun.
Now we kind of like need to grow up.
This is crazy that we're sitting at 10 years and the people that it's impacted and the path that we've taken to get here has been amazing.
Thinking about how MGP was created, thinking about the origin, I have to go back to recognizing being the only person that looked like me in different settings.
The idea of it was really just about what was lacking in our experience.
I didn't see where we were fostering a sense of mentorship and a sense of community within our industry.
You know, part of MGB's responsibility is to communicate about, you know, the needs of inclusion and diversity.
It's an informed responsibility.
It took me a whole year to figure out, what does Marcus Graham mean? He talking about it's based upon some movie with Eddie Murphy. And I say Eddie Murphy is a comedian, man. He already got his money. When the hell are we gonna do something about Eddie Murphy's movie?
We have something very exciting coming up. After months of hard work by our creative team, you are about to see the commercial that will launch our $18 million push for the new Stranger fragrance.
How is it?
I haven't seen that. Let Nelson do it by himself.
Mari's Grand Project, at first, was the thought of doing like a TV show. But a TV show that did something similar to what Boomerang did showed what was possible. I wasn't raised to know that I had a point of difference from a racial perspective. The conversation that most parents have with their kids about how to interact with the police and so forth, I've never had that conversation. My dad was the one that said, when you move to Chicago, the center of your universe is gonna open, because I was exploring the unknown.
When I joined the Air Force and started traveling around, then I realized, hey, what I thought was kind of the norm in Port Arthur wasn't the norm.
It was the same year that Barack Obama was running to become the first African-American president of the United States.
Obama! Obama! Obama!
Not even a close between this type of diversity. What's happening right now is madness. It's a great madness.
Yes, we did! Yes, we did!
It's a great time to learn. What do you think, Larry?
Yeah.
He said, I'm your president, too.
I'm your president, too. I'm for you. I'm for you, even if you're not for me. Yeah, I'm going to fight for you. Yeah. I'm going to give you everything I got.
He did it.
It's not a change, brother. Not a change.
I think that audacity of hope is really what sparked the beginning of MGP.
I was in my bedroom. Everyone was else in the living room. And I remember saying, hey, you know that thing I've been talking about I want to do? I need to do it, but I need to come back home.
Listen, I'm in there every day, and I'm the only black person in there that's trying to do it. They're trying to advertise and market it to black people, and they won't get any input from people that look like me to tell them what kind of advertising that to. What do black folks feel about this? How do you advertise this product? He wasn't trying to be the only black, the first black. I was the only black and the first black, and I think he don't have to go through that, but he was.
He just said, come home, son. And I think that like unlocked something in me. I didn't always appreciate what I thought that my dad was trying to teach me growing up. But he empowered me to explore. He empowered me to explore my dreams. And my life has never been the same.
That boy is so creative and so strong about his commitment that it's hard to hold him back.
I just knew that I wanted to make a difference in people's lives.
I have never seen anybody with that kind of passion that I've been close associated with. And I'm glad it's my son.
That's when the phone call came from Lincoln. He was like, hey, I just quit. He said, I just quit. I'm going to start MGP.
California. The reason I majored in journalism was because at the University of North Texas, the advertising program falls into the journalism school. To be an why, and I want to learn about people.
You know, I see things shifting, mm-hmm. and I'm thrilled that Marcus Graham is a part of that shift in whatever measure. But I see it shifting. The thing that is shifting it, though, is consumers. The market's changing.
The world and business and culture is moving faster than ever, and I think consumers are moving faster than ever, so it's like, how as a brand and an organization do you stay ahead?
Do consumers really even need, you know, companies and corporations and brands and advertising agencies anymore? Do they?
It's really about sort of being hip to hip and like navigating through this world and this life together.
It's not even only about diversity, but it's about diversity and inclusion, you know? And so you're always trying to figure out what that voice looks like.
Pulling in grassroots talent, pulling in people that, you know, who are at the heart of culture and giving them a platform to do and make and to build, to help build their brand and co-author that story.
My experience has been,
I've seen some really horrible advertising. Some advertising that has been like, what? Why would you do that?
One of my good friends, she works at an agency, and she said, they're having a conversation about this shampoo product. And the creative team came to the table with the creative, and they said, we're gonna have this African-American woman, she's gonna wake up. Her hair is gonna be everywhere. She's gonna be running late, but she's gonna go in the shower. She's gonna put the shampoo in her hair. She's gonna come out and she's gonna get ready to and get out the door for her job interview. And we're gonna show her getting the job at the end. The white woman in the room, she raised her hand. She's like, this ad is a little off. And the guy's like, what do you mean? Black women don't go to the bed with their hair unwrapped. So a black woman waking up with her hair all over the place is culturally, like, doesn't culturally fit. And like, this is one of my friends who just happened to be like woke as hell. But if she, like, those are the small cultural cues that if you miss as a brand are unauthentic.
Dad, thanks for always helping me out financially so I can focus on being an independent woman.
White is the new black.
Confused as to how this got approved. It's the independent woman thing and the financial thing, especially growing up in a community where like a lot of women were financially dependent on men, and that kept a lot of people in circumstances that maybe they didn't want to be in. It's just not cool.
What you're seeing from the industry is a sort of a grasp to stay relevant.
Business sometimes goes into kind of get it done mode versus be visionary or dream bigger or better mode. It's an industry about creativity and when difference comes together, different perspectives, different experiences, different types of people, different ideas, different dreams.
I don't think that people are really understanding the value. And when I say value, I mean not only from an emotional level, but the value in terms of a financial level of what you're missing when you don't have diversity and inclusion in the room, because you're not able to tell the story that somebody else is.
It's not a racial thing, it's a cultural thing. And I would say this to anyone, white, black, Hispanic, you know, Italian, French, whatever. If you've ever been submerged in my culture for long enough, then you probably understand it, and vice versa. But if you haven't, don't attempt to understand it on your own. Right? Get some help, because I would never go to France and attempt to try things that are bound to your culture without having some type of respect for the experiences and research that you've done with your own experiences in the years. I need you to come with me, because I need to know what enjoying this means or talking about this means. So I think that's the biggest issue that we have, is that people ignore the culture of what it is to be in advertising.
I'm just not trying to understand what a black woman shops for. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to understand her psyche, you know, her as a human.
You would think that a place that services so many different types of people, that it would just make sense that that type of industry would employ those same different types of people. That the talent that you saw and the decision makers sitting at those tables would look like the people you were actually servicing.
The spirit of the program at the beginning was that
young talent needed an opportunity within the marketing world. But the reality, I think, is the opposite. Marketing needs this young talent.
Without, you know, certain perspectives, like everything would be bland or dull, or, you know, everything would be solved with a can of Pepsi.
I grew up in a world where I didn't know that these things were happening. My dad didn't walk with me, but I grew up with kids who didn't even know their dads.
There's people who will say, everybody stop complaining and blaming.
There's a difference between claiming a victimhood and standing up and saying that the playing field is not level.
People have whittled down what we're saying into, oh, I only want this because I am a black man, or because I'm a Latina woman, or because I'm an Asian woman, right? But it's not that. It's like, no, we just want a seat at the table. We just want a say, not just a seat, a say at the table.
So a lot of our friends that we went to college with, we graduated at the same time. We all went out and got our jobs. But some of them, when they went to get their job, they had an easier time getting into corporate America and climbing the ladder.
I catch myself asking myself first, and then I'm so confused that I have to ask them, how are you not hired? And how did somebody not hire you?
One of the things I would hear before I became a hiring manager was that we couldn't find the right candidates. And I'm thinking, I knew lots of people that graduated with me. I belonged to organizations, so I knew these people existed.
That comes up in meetings all the time. Okay, how can we look at it from this angle or from this angle? But everyone's the same.
There are so many talented women currently working at the height of their game, at the depth of their talents, and to tell me you can't find one? When you look at these movies and these franchises and these global brands that are dominating because they are inclusive both in front of and behind the cameras, there's no business excuse for not doing that. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't make number sense.
Lonnie Grenier, she's a professor at Harvard. She has this speech that she gives that I think is fascinating. Let's say the highest you get on the test is a 5. If Bob gets a 4, and Billy gets a 3, and Jane gets a 2, in America, the guy that got the 4 and the guy that got the 3 are the people you hire, because they got the most questions right. But what if Jane, who got the 2, got the questions that she got right were the questions that the guy that got the 4 and the guy that got the 3 got wrong? Technically, you want to hire Bob, who got the 4, and Jane, who got the 2. Because clearly she's thinking differently than the other two guys if she got the questions right that they got wrong. We have to reshape and reconfigure how we think and how we hire and how we bring certain people to the table.
It's not that the talent isn't there, it's that we haven't made a concerted effort to care for that talent and mentor that talent and show the talent, you know, where to go, how to go, and when to go.
If Marcus Graham wasn't finding a good fight or wasn't bringing people to the table, or educating people about advertising, like, honestly, the work wouldn't be good. It's the same thing over and over again. And we've seen that multiple times through multiple brands, through multiple agencies that do work that just doesn't connect to people.
People say it's the right thing to do. People say we have to have a rich tapestry in our companies. But I think it is a business imperative. When you don't have diverse perspective, you are purposefully ignoring large segments of the population.
What's so interesting is that that's now even falling in with minority groups, and to where I think that a lot of minorities are thinking, oh, well, yeah, it's easy to break into advertising and that you can just do it, but it is very, very tough. You get into advertising, right? But then you are just like swamped because you are consistently trying to make sure that you're still in advertising, because you don't see a lot of people in advertising like you. Your level of how you work and what you're having to do is like times 100, and you have to go so hard and so strong. But then eventually you get to a place where people finally say like, wow, that is a great creative. And it always comes down to the work.
I was given an offer to take a role in my company that I had been with for maybe at the time 9 years. Mm-hmm. Suddenly they wanted me to be head of multicultural. Mind you, this is a general market agency that maybe has 2% minority, maybe, and we don't have a multicultural practice. Mm-hmm. I remember saying to my boss, who was making this proposition to me, why me? And of course it made her uncomfortable, because why me was because my skin is brown. We're not all experts just because we actually happen to be that color. I What that does is undermine every multicultural agency because it says it doesn't take any training or education. You just need to be black, or you just need to be Latina, or you just need to be gay, or you just need to be, and that's it, you suddenly get it. My perspective goes way beyond my color. It has to do with my experiences, it has to do with what I've learned along the way in marketing, it has to do with my background. I think the program's mission, certainly to attract people of diverse perspectives, is much more important.
We have to figure out a way to actually change the mindset of a culture that is used to being homogenous. And I really thank Lincoln for actually taking the bull by the horn and at least trying to do something about it.
There's an understanding that says, like, if someone doesn't agree with you, it may come from the fact that they have had a completely different experience.
I totally agree.
The reason I am so passionate, and I'm not hostile, I'm passionate. The reason I am so passionate is because I've had such a different experience in this country than you.
Jen C. Keaton, who actually offered me the role, I think she not only saw something in me, but she wanted to include others, you know, because I was the only Hispanic and brown person on the marketing and advertising team, a team of probably like 50 or 60. And I walked in there and I felt like, whoa.
There are very, very few that I think you're just being mean-spirited and spiteful. I really don't. I really think it's coming from a really uninformed place.
We are naturally tribal, so we come from different communities, different cultures. So our cultural norms and things that we're used to doing is what we do at home. When we get to corporate America, it's a mixed bucket or mixed bag of things, of people's cultures and norms. So a lot of times when a lot of people have been hired from one community and they don't see people who look like them, and someone who doesn't look like them comes in and they do things a little bit different, it's frowned upon, it's treated differently.
If you're only around men, if you're only around women, like all those things play a factor.
Like just because you and I are brown doesn't mean we're on the same page.
Right.
On the same page. I mean, you're a young Hispanic woman, I'm an older African-American woman.
It's not natural to be diverse. It's not natural to step outside yourself and be like, I'm gonna hang with them, I'm gonna work with them, I'm gonna understand them. That takes work. That's not a natural thing. It's natural to stay in your circle.
That's not what change is. Change is looking at a greater good for everybody. I wanna go to work with Bob, and Bob be like, this is my partner, and I feel positive about him. I think in the past, a lot of people thought that we were looking for a favor, a handout, or something different. What we really want is a big, strong community. And when one person struggles, we all struggle.
I note the obvious differences in the human family. Some of us are serious. Some thrive on comedy. I've sailed upon the seven seas and stopped in every land. I've seen the wonders of the world. Not yet one common man. I know 10,000 women called Jane and Mary Jane. I've not seen any two who really were the same. I note the obvious differences between each sort and type, but we are more alike, my friends, than we are unalike. We are more alike, my friends, than we are unalike.
My biggest fear is to succeed and not knowing what that looks like, kind of losing touch. And I don't know what that looks like. I don't think I've been successful in many things, but the kind of success that I want to reach, I think that's what I'm afraid of. And I think that's what keeps me from getting there. After doing this, like the same confidence of when I did the boot camp is kind of coming out again.
Why wouldn't you take that opportunity to create some sense of inclusion, to open up the fandom, to say that this is for everyone, to say that we're going to represent the world as it exists?
Because
it just upsets me. It makes me mad. It makes me sad. Why are we still here? Why can't we be better?
Media and advertising by byproduct, they shape the world's perspective. And reality, and perspective is reality, right?
One of the beautiful things about, I think, about the LGBTQ movement, I think it's so powerful. What made, I think, that movement get so many victories in a short period of time was that they were able to capture, I think, the imagination of people. I think that there was a way of humanizing our gay and lesbian brothers and sisters.
Can you stand up
for people that you are not necessarily fully part of that community in a way that you can understand what you all go through, right? I don't know that a lot of people would understand that, but it's because of what you've been through. You have survived so much that you inspire me to continue surviving.
If you're conservative or you're liberal, everyone knows someone who is of the LGBTQ community.
I wish everyone in the world would know what it feels like to be your sister.
And when you see people as human, it creates progress.
When the film Black Panther comes out, we've not seen ourselves as Black people in that hero character like that.
It's so important to have a sense of pride in who you are and your background. And for me, growing up in high school, being one of 110 students in a class that is Black, you often can go back into yourself because you don't want to be different. So when I started to learn more about my heritage and more about my culture, it really let me come out of my shell a little bit more. And to have such a confidence knowing your background and your history and that you have a strength and you don't have to fit in or conform, I think that's everything. I think that's the intangible thing that the Marcus Graham Project can offer. You really understand how to be proud of who you are and where you come from.
They said on there, be yourself, and so I thought, now do they really mean be yourself? Or is that a trick question? Do I want to be myself in the safe space?
Which self?
Yeah, right. Which self?
The one that makes you acceptable to the general market that will be interviewing you?
Yes.
Or
can I be myself?
Can I be myself?
Can I be myself? Right. So I got my biggest hoop earrings, and I wore my boyfriend jeans and a white t-shirt and some heels. Women were wearing slacks and heels, and they were dressed up so nice. And I was like, well, this is myself. And so, and I love it.
I was the first Black to integrate an all-white school. That's not miraculous. It happens. I have a strong character. It was tough, but it's fine, right? This is what I remember from that experience. People were always saying to me, shh. Like, I'm too assertive, I'm too loud, I've got too much me, you know? You should be willing to represent your whole self, mm-hmm. not half yourself. Yeah. So you don't want to talk about the part of you that makes you uncomfortable mm-hmm. or makes them uncomfortable. Let's get to the root cause here.
There are a million and one forces out there that are going to stop you from doing or being or existing in your own skin, in your own body, in your own mind. The world is not one color. The world is not one sex. The world is not one identity. It's so much more than that. Just the fact that I got into MGP really helped me like bring things back to myself and say, okay, yeah, this is who you are, and this is what you're capable of, and don't ever doubt yourself.
What MPG does for a lot of young people like you mm-hmm. is to give you the courage mm-hmm. and the confidence to know, wait a minute, I don't have to be stuck in a bubble. Right. I can break out of this. I've got more, and I'm going to insist that people hear that I have more. And so now you're doing it, so you've been set free.
Yeah.
So what Marcus Graham did was to set you free.
For me, I've just always seen my mom as like a hard worker. To come here to America and at one point having 15 women work for her, I wanted to do something like that. I didn't know what, but I just knew that I wanted to be a powerful woman, just like my mom. Great story. Yeah. You gave your father a kidney.
I did.
Wow.
Yeah. You know, it wasn't even a thought.
My mother has a bachelor's, and she actually got it when I was in high school. She went back to school, which I was excited to see that happen for her, and it inspired me.
My grandma has always been like one of the biggest advocates for what I do. You know, she's my heart, and she's my sword and my shield.
My great-grandfather was one of the first African-Americans, a freedman, to buy land in the state of Texas. So he built a school on his land, and he educated all the kids who worked in the fields up to the eighth grade for years, and it was literally a school that they built on the property.
One of the things that I get when I talk to young kids, it's like, oh wow, you do that? Like, I didn't know someone like me could do that.
When the Marcus Graham Project started, I think a year into it, my daughter was born. And I took her to everything. And I didn't care how people looked at me. And Lincoln is now taking his son to everything. Because his son needs to see what it looks like when you stand up and speak, when you go on to a business meeting. I mean, my daughter's gone to ad meetings with me before and watched me pitch. And she's like, wow, Daddy, I didn't know you stand up in front of people like that. She's 7 years old.
The impact of what I do right now has an effect on almost two-year-old's grandchildren. How I choose to view the world and how I choose to view myself and how I raise him has an impact on his grandchildren. And it's an awesome responsibility.
Don't ever forget how bad you wanted what you have right now. People are forgetting about that sweet spot in which they were so passionate about what they were doing that they brought others along with them, you know? And it's becoming more about me.
More about doing right for the brands and doing right, you know, for your career and furthering your career.
I'm always thinking about the 18-year-old that was in Atlanta that could not get a job, that knew he was good, humbly.
Well, my mentor, Tadeem Ushery, he's the guy that introduced me to the president of MSG Sports, who got me how I wound up getting the Madison Square Garden. Without that intro, I don't get that job. And I told him, I said, I don't know how to repay you. He said, just pay it forward. Pay it forward.
Always check in. Who can I talk to? Be a resource. Lincoln is the most connected person in the universe. So hit him up and just see, you know, what can I do?
People saying, hey, I'm coming to LA this weekend. What's going on? Hey, I'll meet you. And they've never met each other, but they're in the family. Because that's what family does. They argue with each other. They disagree on topics. They get back together, but they stay strong.
As, you know, I grow, as I meet new people, as I advance in my career, I'm still at that spot. And you want to know what? I will always be at that spot mentally because I know that it's a struggle for someone else.
The judge, who happens to be, we believe, Mexican, which is great. I think that's fine.
You think that's fine? Great news, people of Mexican descent. Donald Trump thinks it's fine for you to be a human being existing on this planet.
This is what I'm wearing, guys.
Are you really?
This is what I'm wearing. Okay. Yes, I am a citizen. Can you please get away from me?
See, the police are not.
You're not going to change us. You know that?
This is why traditional Republicans struggle with his leadership. We can't forgive it. We can't normalize it. We can't suggest that he can be the figure of a party that we subscribe to. It's heartbreaking. It's not an easy conversation.
That's all so many of us are saying. And at this point, I'm emotional.
And let's fix it.
Because we can't, we cannot, like, it's like being constantly gaslit. We're constantly being told, I'm told every day I'm on air that I'm racist because I call out racism. That is maddening to me. And I'm crying about it because it's crazy. And I wish
and
that somebody who's a colleague of mine, like
it.
Alice, could at least acknowledge that fact. Like, that is so frustrating. We're supposed to be talking about a 12-year-old boy who was just trying to deliver newspapers and the police are called on him in Ohio where Tamir Rice was killed and the same age. I want to be acknowledged and seen.
And to show the next generation that we haven't forgotten how hard people have fought for human rights. We cannot do this. We can't go backward.
She said, is there any way we can make our appointment later for this afternoon, more like 3 or 4? I think that's fine, right?
Yeah.
What time are we planning to leave?
7, right?
Yeah.
What does woke mean to you?
Oh, wow.
What does woke mean to you?
A deep question.
Woke. To have a continuous thirst of knowledge.
Being woke means realizing who I am, realizing my place in the world and realizing what other people see me as, checking my privilege at the door, whether it be my black privilege, because I do believe and there's a such thing as black privilege, my male privilege.
Woke is operating out of spirit, and out of spirit, I don't think there's race. Out of spirit, I don't think there's a conversation about diversity. Spirit is when I meet you, I have discernment over spirit. And that's what I think is being woke. So everything I'm looking for is, what's the spirit behind it? And I think as long as you're looking for the spirit behind something, you'll always be woke.
Woke is just being aware and sensitive to the fact that you don't know as much as you think you know. But you shouldn't be ashamed to teach what you do know, even though you could be wrong, right? Because that's what connects us as human beings. Being woke doesn't mean being brave, because that's another attribute that you have to learn to have, right?
To me, it's like being very in tune with like who you are and what you believe. And even if like the world is zagging when you're zigging, is like trusting that your zig is who you are and it's gonna get you to where you wanna go. I think it's a feeling, but it's also action. Like they kind of go together. And I think the action is for you to personally define.
I am taking steps to make sure that my privilege or the privilege of others doesn't, you know, negatively impact anyone. It's easy to be Twitter woke, to be Facebook woke, mm-hmm. to be Snapchat woke and post and do hashtags and things like that. But it's, what are you doing in your community on that grassroots level? Are you going to the protests? Are you going to the city council meeting? You know, things like that. Are you calling your congressman? Are you calling your senator?
You know, we're responsible for our knowledge. You have to create this, I guess, filter for yourself to understand, like, the root and the beginnings of some ideas and to make sure that they're authentic to the people and not that they're being appropriated or being misused.
You know, more than ever, we need what it implies. And I think it implies at its best the ability to empathize with people that have a different experience or a different background than you. So woke can mean many things. For me, it's how does a white dude from Minnesota like me end up starting a company with one of the most famous NBA athletes of all time? It doesn't mean that we started out in the same place, but it means we're able to find a common ground. It's we're able to find shared passions and move forward from there.
That's a hard question. That's a hard question.
How do you feel?
Like, I don't know. I keep going like this. Yeah. When you say woke, it's almost like my nonverbal response would be,
Jay Blacks posted something on Facebook. So I was asked today about wokeness and what it meant to me. Being woke to me means consciousness. Knowing what's going on around me, the systems in place to help and hurt us while searching for knowledge of self and others. While also being aware and checking my male privilege at the door and understanding that it's twice as hard for me as a Black man to get ahead, and it's 3 to 4 times as harder for women of color, especially Black women. I love y'all so much. Lastly, using my Black privilege to uplift people of all race, ethnicities, communities, sexual orientations, preferences, and identities while showing Black and brown kids that anything is possible and you're worth and capable of everything you set your mind and heart to. What's your meaning of being woke? Jay.
If it hadn't been for Bill Sharp, I don't know how many Black people would have gotten into advertising.
They started this with the intention of getting us so ready that we could not be subjected to the standard excuses of, you don't know anything about this, we don't know if you can do the kind of work we want, you're not qualified.
The basic advertising course laid the groundwork for the proliferation of image of Black people in America. It sounds like a big thing to say that one small class and could have done something like that, but it would have had a lot to do with it.
I learned about the first industry-sponsored program at that time, African Americans in the advertising industry. I swear I was on the phone with Bill Sharp for 2 hours just getting notes. He sent me a primer that he had created called How to Be Black and Get a Job in the Advertising Business Anyway. He said, we're still in the same place, like 40, you know, coming up on 45 years. Why should we continue? And I remember Mr. Sharp saying, don't you ever stop.
The reason that that Lincoln and I connected so well is because my personal mission aligned with what his vision was for what Marcus Graham would do, mm-hmm. is doing. It was apparent that he is a stand-apart human. Mm-hmm. Even as a young person out of college, he was articulate, he was clear about his heart and who he was as a man and a human and his place in the universe.
After I left Madison Square Garden Company, I was looking to transition to like the advertising world, mm-hmm. and his name came up probably like 2,000 times. Everyone was like, you gotta talk to Lincoln, you gotta meet Lincoln, you gotta meet Lincoln. I mean, who's this Lincoln guy?
He by far had the most like entrepreneurial, disruptive, visionary, youthful, you know, approach to ensuring that this industry is really like a hub of different perspectives and experiences and people of all backgrounds.
After doing all the marching and all the protesting back in my youth, I was tired. So I didn't think about how to move it forward. I just tried to touch one person at a time. But I saw it in Lincoln from the time we first started talking. I knew that I didn't hear the end. I wouldn't hear the end of it. He was, you know, wherever he was going, that was not going to be the end of it. He had that ball in his hand, and it almost was like when you know, like, whoever met Martin Luther King for the first time, you know that these people are chosen to do something, and that's how I felt about it.
I still remember the first summer when there was no place for the interns to stay, there was no office building, there was nothing. All we had was a big dream, and it was Lincoln's dream. And we wanted to make sure that it happened because we could see the value in him being successful and it, what it would do for so many others.
I see how driven the young people and the students are, but I also see how overwhelmed and nervous they are.
When you are somebody that is creative, it's so hard for you to really understand what you're doing, and then it's also so hard for you to accept that you're different. I will never forget when I was first breaking into just being a graphic designer, a creative, you know, my dad would say things like, hey, you know, what is this, this paint and, you know, this art stuff, you know, you need a book bag and, you know, you need pen and paper. You need to be a doctor. And I'm like,
I've always been the creative guy in the family.
I was 29. Getting ready to go on 30.
If you asked me what advertising at the time was TV commercials. I had no idea what a creative director was.
You know, the marketing and advertising was a hard area to get into. If you don't know the right people, I mean, it's that type of industry. You know, if you don't know the people that you can befriend that will help you move into that next arena or area or elevate you, or you have the right mentorship, you won't get here. Because you just don't know where to look. And even if you are a great candidate, think about how many candidates get eliminated now because there's not enough room.
If you can kind of take sort of the wisdom of like a program like Marcus Graham Project with the fire and the drive and the passion and the dreams of like talent and put that together, like it's important, I think, for the next generation of talent to have that.
14 of the best talent in advertising
have come from all over the world
to work and live together for one summer.
With one commonality,
our passion for advertising.
We are the link between the global community
and today's culture.
And as such, we have a global vision.
Fit the youthful perspective.
We are Wi-Fi.
My name is Maria. I come from Spain and I am an art director.
My name is Rosi Sánchez. I am from Dallas, Texas. I am the media strategist.
Cynthia Newman, and I'm from the UK. And I'm a creative director.
My name is Alvaro Gabaldon. I'm from Florida and I'm a brand manager.
There's a little something different about our alumni. And maybe it has to do with our program or maybe just our ability to find the right type of people. But I think, you know, they hold that intangible something.
When I applied, you know, I didn't really have much of a background. And so I was just like, come on, Jesus, do it. And I remember Lincoln called me to tell me I was accepted and I was driving. And I was just overjoyed. Like, I think after I hung up, I gave him one of those, yeah.
Yeah, awesome.
Video comes on. I'm like the fourth face that pops up. And wow, I was just like, yo, I got in. This is okay. What's up?
Same day, I went back to my boss and was like, yo, my 2 weeks notice, here you go.
And when I first got there, Jesus, it was like a little a kid in the candy store because the lofts are so big and you're just like, all in one building and the office is there, and then we were over at the agency we were working at, and it was just so much access to just great stuff.
I like ran down the hall
yelling. I used to just go to him and his roommate's place downtown, and it was like a young Russell Simmons of like magazines and stuff on the window, and then we would just have these conversations about life and what you're looking to do and how you could do it.
It was never about let's get your foot in the door, but it's how do we get you to stay and rise the ranks and get to the top.
We like to call it the rock star lifestyle of corporate, but at the same time, it's not pretty.
There's gonna be nights where you're working to 2 a.m, 3 a.m. There's gonna be nights where you're frustrated.
I remember laughing at fights. A lot of times you don't live, well, you might meet your significant other, but you don't live with your coworkers.
I've seen a lot of other organizations, it's almost a one and done. So you do the program, you have a great time and it's over, but you don't really have an opportunity to stay engaged and stay connected. But with MGP, it's been the complete opposite. I can call Lincoln and Larry anytime I want. The same goes with the other people in the program. I was just talking to Lincoln yesterday.
I don't even know where I would be right now had that moment of me deciding, like, go do your portfolio, go do your pitch video, go. If I didn't decide to do that, if I just decided, nah, you know, I'm cool. I'm kind of cool. I'll just work this job. Because the moment that you think it's going to happen with your current situation, it's not. You gotta lose that apartment, lose that house, lose that car. You know, and all of that's got to go away for you to get what you want.
If you have a dream, go for it. If that dream means that you have to work 1,000,000 hours, go for it. If that dream means that you have to miss holidays, vacations, to learn something you don't know, go for it.
Right at that moment, move on it. Move on your faith, move on the hope that you'll be successful at whatever that thing is.
The Marcus Graham Project is a project put together to give you the opportunity to carve your own path. And what that means is if you're given the time, you're given the space, you're given the resources, go for it. Go for it.
In your campaign video, you said, women like me aren't supposed to run for office.
Mm-hmm. You know what? If no one else is going to do it, and if I feel like we can be better, then that means it's my responsibility to do something. Sunshine.
You got me in my feelings. My dad came over here to this country in pursuit of just something better. I think for him, it's very important that we keep a piece of our heritage with us always, no matter where we go.
I think my family was extremely creative. They came here with nothing. They came here as immigrants, and they found a way to make businesses and to thrive in this country.
So good.
This being year 10, so many people want to be in the Marcus Graham Project.
For these individuals to start their summer at Wieden Kennedy, Apple, Fossil, it's huge.
One of the beautiful things that we got to learn at Wieden and Kennedy was this whole theme of cultures matter. Really getting a chance to understand that cultures exist, cultures experience, but most importantly, cultures really express themselves to exist in this dynamic world in which we live in today.
It's the 10th anniversary of the Marcus Graham Project, and it's really important to us that we honor all the work that Larry and Lincoln and Ramon do year in and year out. And we operate as a family unit. We live together, we work together, we play together, we succeed together. We do everything together. And we really believe that that allows us to get to know each other and also support each other better. And when we work with our clients, we try to have that same family relationship with them as well. We live in a very interconnected world, but unfortunately, a lot of the connections we make are really superficial. We want to change that and make sure that when we're working with our clients and addressing their audiences, that we make sure we have genuine connections that form strong bonds and good relationships.
A good store, I think, is honestly good marketing, good advertising. Sometimes we know that brands might not always do the best job of appealing to that culture or to that story, so that's why it's really important for us as Connection to help these brands, help our clients find ways to make a stronger connection that's culturally courageous, that's timely, and that's really authentic to who we are and to what we represent.
The talent that comes out of the Marcus Graham Project is absolutely phenomenal.
If I'm a company, I'm like, come here. I want you here. I want that brain power here.
They bring a level of excitement to advertising. Advertising is an exciting industry. I'm too much for my damn self.
There's so much excitement within the organization, and I'm really proud to be at an organization that that is helping MGP.
When I tell people I'm a part of the Marcus Graham Project, I smile and I think about, you know, sort of the every boot camp generation that's come after me has been better and better.
I think you would find that MGP talent is diverse. And by diverse, I don't mean just in creed, orientation, ethnicity. I think they're diverse in skill set. They kind of teeter on that hybrid line. Like, they can do so many different things.
Running your own pop-up agency with 9 other people that you live with, that's a very unique experience that I don't think other programs offer. So we weren't just going to work and coming home. We actually had book assignments that we had to do. We were hosting our own radio show. We also had networking events. I think what stood out for me is actually the video portion of it.
I actually had seen a Univision advertisement, and it had inspired me, and I said, this is what I want. I want it to be like, this is who I am, and I want it to be about my heritage, my culture. I just remember being in tears, like, this is perfect, this is what I wanted. And I was so proud to stand behind that. So I submitted it to MGP, and they liked it, and I think it was like hit right on the nail.
Having this program and being able to bring minorities in, mm-hmm. and further them to be able to tell those stories and etch out their truth in the space of media and advertising and marketing is overly important, because without it, we're lost. We're being told false truths that continue to become people's reality because they don't know any better.
But you're so enthusiastic. I feel like you think that we're going to come out of this better than when we started.
Yes.
What?
Yeah, and you know why?
Tell me.
Because we don't have any choice.
Sitting around here fanning ourselves and liking the things, that's not work. When Obama ran and won in 2008, 2012, everybody that I know was working.
Our charge is specifically about media marketing and advertising. If we do the right thing here, that becomes contagious. You know, that, you know, when people leave our program or leave the industry, they still remember what they experienced with MGP.
Yeah, I work at an agency who has resources and things like that that could be used to, you know, to help with criminal justice reform, to help get the message out that, you know, climate change is not a hoax, right? It's even at the local level. It doesn't have to be this big national statement.
Maybe the brands that you sponsor and wear, what you talk about on social media, what you allow your parents or your family to engage with. It's really having a strong sense of cultural understanding that means you'll protect where you came from and know and understand that no one can ever disrespect that.
So Flush Beauty is a new prestige makeup line that came to Ulta recently, and I was immediately drawn to it because it is prestige makeup that focuses on every single skin tone and being very inclusive, because it's important. And even sometimes I feel like I'm not doing enough to make sure that my dollar is being spent towards inclusive brands.
So this is Cindy Ramirez, and she's one of the influencers that we got for 2018 campaign and our cast member. So this is what she looks like, right? Cindy Ramirez, she's really cool. She's, again, the founder of Chill House. She's an entrepreneur, she's young, she's Latina, she's pretty cool, right? Here's her, like, in a coat, just awesome, looking fabulous. When I look at brands and I see them take people like this and turn them into this, they've hired them for a purpose, to be themselves and work with the brand, but then we change them to the point where it's almost like they don't even look like themselves in our campaigns. This just looks like another girl to me, and I wished we could have grabbed her aesthetic and look as herself. She's a curious person, she's vivacious, she's got so much energy. And so this is a true organic Instagram photo. She's having fun, she looks amazing. I wanna be this girl.
If advertising wasn't what I'm supposed to do in my life, in the long run, in the grand scheme of everything, it put the fire in me to explore within myself, like, what that purpose is, and, like, creatively how I can make an impact in this industry while I'm here.
I think education is in it for you. And I think opportunity, in whatever way you see fit or that you can create, isn't it for you. I think you should definitely have a thought of, what am I looking to get? What am I hoping to get out of it? But I think that needs to be paired with, it's bigger than me.
Whatever that thing is that's keeping you from, you know, doing what you want to do, I want to help people realize that. I want to help people get that and obtain that kind of self-confidence to where they feel like they can do anything.
To me, I always refer to MGP as an army. We are here to protect and serve the talent. I think there's some amazing people out here that do some amazing work, and a lot of them have no idea that they are amazing, you know, and it's sort of our job, you know, to foster that amazement, help them mold it, and then push them out into the world the same way you would do, you know, your child, that, you know, you care for their talents and care for their passions, and then, you know, give them enough so that when they go out into the world that they can succeed.
People find out that they were a part of MGP and learn about it after the fact. But they always knew that there was something special about them and how they're able to move throughout their career.
I believe it was year two, team MetaThink. Sebastian Go, he was in the middle of the lemonade stand, it was a mixer that we have, and he just grabbed my hand and he shook my hand, and he said in the most sincerest of ways, "This is by far the most impactful thing I've ever done in my life." He said, "I've spent 4 years at Duke, and I feel like I've learned more in 3 weeks here with the Marcus Graham Project than I've learned in my entire tenure at Duke." Sometimes you feel like, okay, you're just gassing me, you know, but he was so sincere, and I could see it in his eyes, and I've taken that moment with me every single year, every time we have, you know, trouble finding the money or, you know, another obstacle to overcome, you know, I reach back to that moment and I remember it because I know he's not the only one.
So Yvonne Kinzer is the head of digital marketing at Avocados from Mexico. They did this campaign where they had to move the float across this parade for Thanksgiving, Macy's Thanksgiving parade in Times Square. In order for the float to move, people had to tweet. And so people were tweeting, and making the float move. And so by the time that the float got to the New York Times Square for the Thanksgiving parade, people on Twitter were commenting, "Oh my gosh, there's my float, look, my float made it." People were referring to the brand as a part of themselves, ownership of the brand. And I asked her, I said, "Well, how, you know, what did you think when that happened, when you saw those tweets coming in?" And she said, "I mean, for a brand, it was everything for us." She said that was our measure of success right there. And I think that's what real and digital and social media advertising is. It's you're not even trying to carry the conversation. At that point, you know you've done a good job when people and the community are driving the conversations for you. Let me just show you her picture, because she's like me, but she's like actually doing things. Agility, innovation, and guacamole. Avocados from Mexico and Yvonne Kinzer. Look at her.
Got it. Save that. She's great.
She's a true digital strategist, and I aspire to be like her. And she's, Avocados from Mexico has beat out any other brand in the Super Bowl year for the past 2 years. So one of these days, I want to go toe-to-toe during the Super Bowl with Yvonne, and I'm going to beat her out on those mentions. Watch out, Yvonne, because I'm coming for you, girl. One of these days, Super Bowl, me and you.
Ten years in, we've kind of accomplished a lot, but we're kind of on a cusp. We've seen what we're capable of. Now, where do we go from here?
We can no longer be a charity. We can no longer be, because what's happened is there are organizations and people that see us through the lens of charity, and then therefore see our young leaders as charity cases. We are a solution to a problem.
There is no more excuses. There is no more. If we need to have the conversation on diversity, let's have it. But here is a range of talent, a range of diverse individuals that can solve every problem that you have within your agency.
I want to see companies all across this country embrace MGP. There's no reason why every company around this country is not knocking on the door.
Don't undermine the program by making it something as
make it about something as small as let's get brown people in marketing. We have to continue to say let's get diverse thinking, let's get unique perspectives, let's bring different ways to solve problems. Let's bring that. I see it happening. So the good news is that that's not a lecture. That's me saying continue to do what you're doing and continue to push the program. They'll never become complacent or satisfied that we're making progress. It's never enough progress. We always need a little bit more.
We need more than 11 to 15 students per year. We need 1,100 to 1,500 students per year.
I imagine there have been highs and lows, and Lincoln spoke about some of the challenges last year at Lavender Hill, but yet there's always this eternal optimism and faith.
It's a faith-based thing, and you know the saying, faith is things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
About to do my panel for Career Contessa. Stay tuned, and it's gonna be really exciting, really cool. I love the space. I don't know if you've ever been, but it's amazing. I wanna make sure that I'm authentic to myself and my heritage and my background, and I'm not gonna try to change that in any way. And that's when I shine the most. Like, that's whenever I really do, like, people tend to, you know, pay attention, is whenever I'm being me and doing me. And so for me, it would have to be like a big gold hoop. Like, that's whenever, like, if I'm there's a meeting on the calendar that I need to look my best, I'm like, oh, let's take the gold hoops out, and like, let's just make sure that, like, my Oak Cliff style is coming through.
I'm glad that we're a gold hoop event for you. I'm flattered.
Everyone has their own path. And so don't ever compare yourself to another woman. Don't ever look at anyone else. And that way you never know when this person who you're helping might end up in a completely different space or how it's gonna come full circle. I always just kind of remember how hard it was for me trying to get my voice heard and making, paving my way in my career. And so I always just, when I look at another woman and team or whatever we're doing, I always just wanna help her be the best she can be.
We have more people now that are willing to actually sit down at the table and actually talk. And if we don't talk about the things that that affect and infect us the most, then it's a lot like a cancer, you know, that's untreated. It's just gonna continue to get worse.
The sort of political climate that we're in today has really made everyone everywhere sort of take another look at it. What is our purpose? What is my purpose?
You know, it's bigger than black or white at this point. It's really, what do we do to make the world better?
The landscape of the United States is changing, whether we want to believe it or not. And the population is shifting. And so to deliver the right messaging, to deliver the right content, we need to have people who look like the communities that are buying the goods.
Who's creating these ads? Who's creating the messaging?
Who's creating the marketing campaigns?
Who we are is what's gonna be, is rising up right now. And MGP is part of that rising.
And if we don't continue to foster and really hold on to our stories, they will be untold.
The challenges that we have in society in terms of race and culture and gender and equality, because those are hard and we're gonna fight those, but we can have fun.
We need stories that are told that represent this culture, not the culture of the past, and I think it needs to be representative of what this world should be. I think we should be telling stories of what we want to see, what we're seeing now, and it needs to be inclusive. This country is based on inclusiveness, and so together we're better. We gotta continue to tell those stories, and those stories don't look like one thing and sound like one person.
What MGP has done is sort of give birth to voices. There's like 100 other me's that have come from MGP that are in these agencies and are really changing perceptions of diversity. And like I said, this is not just about a seat at the table, it's about the say at the table. And I think what we're doing as an organization is once we get at that table, we are making such an impact and a statement that people are sort of taking another look at what diversity even means.
Lincoln and the Marcus Graham Project have really taking the right steps forward into making it a true representation of the world we live in.
There's so many people that are participating with these great brands, and marketers are desperate for the young talent and the storytellers that come out of programs like Marcus Graham Project.
I envision us as one of your most recognized agencies in the industry. That's where I see us 10 years from now. I think carrying the flag of diversity inside of the industry, I think that's where we stand 10 years from now.
I don't care if we only affect one person's life. It's one more person. And maybe everybody that's been through the program has been affected and now can show up at whatever organization that they're at and be heard because of their intelligence, because of their perspective, because of their background, because of whatever. Then we've won already. There's still more to do, but we're already won. We've already run. We're already winning.
The more that I can constantly grow in the industry, learn more, and actually be a thought leader at the table, I'll be able to provide opportunities for the 18-year-old black boy that thinks that he can never make it in advertising.
For companies looking to hire one of our alums, they should know that in the mind of our alumni, they're looking at taking the CEO's job soon, and very soon. You can't accomplish your dreams, to the little voice inside of my head that challenged me to try to give up. You never know light if you don't know darkness. It has only made me stronger as a person. It's only made our organization stronger to have the opponent to test our resolve, my resolve, but be it further resolved, we're not going anywhere.
Pass me the pill. The pill, right? The black pill? Yeah. Beats by Dre. I love this song.
It's by Gambino.
There you go.
Yes.
Queen. And then, you know, I got the Kendrick. You gotta listen to Kendrick again.
It's been on my repeat every time at the gym. I'm like, it's like one more set. I'm like,
Yeah. It's like DNA, element, loyalty, love. But this is my favorite song right now.
Rub my eyes. Took me a second, but I realized that I'm still the same man I was yesterday. See, I made a promise to myself to make a change and better myself, but I don't feel any difference, and that's a shame.
All I want is to be a better man. This late again, but I know the change. No, it don't come easy to me. Change. All I want is change. No, it don't come easy to me. Don't you come a little easier to me?
Now stay woke.